Good morning, everyone. The Honorable Union Minister for Agriculture in absentia, who has just addressed us and taken leave. Honorable Minister for Agriculture, Government of Bihar, Dr. Prem Kumar, the Director General of FICCI, Dilip Chanoy, Kurt Schultz, who has just addressed us, Mr. Sanjay Kaul, my senior colleague in the service, Sunil Kumar Singh, APC Bihar, and Ashok Kumar Verma, all the fellow participants and friends from the media. Thank you once again. I would not labor to repeat what has been said, and I'm sure you're going to hear so much more. I think all of us sitting here are already converts to the value of maize. So much so to emphasize that it is a universal crop. It is universal in terms of geographical spread. It is universal in terms of adaptability. It is universal in terms of multiple uses. And therefore, it has a value. And it certainly has a greater value in today's context of India, where agriculture sector has been imparted a paradigm shift over the last few years, where now we are confident that we can transit from a pure production-oriented agriculture to income-centric agriculture. The rationale behind this is that now we realize it is the market forces that have to actually incentivize agriculture sector. The farmers also are looking at price signals so that they would be able to practice agriculture as an enterprise which is based on positive net returns. We are not looking at a subsistence economy where the production is meant for the family consumption. The production surpluses are certainly bound to go up. They've already gone up. And therefore, the biggest challenge is really how do we market it. Now, maize is something which actually fits as a good candidate into this entire new paradigm of an income-oriented approach to practicing agriculture. And the second challenge that agriculture in India is facing is resource endowment, which is under great stress, whether in terms of soils, in terms of water, and in terms of other natural inputs, but also from the new challenge of the climate. So therefore, maize, which is actually a climate-resilient crop and an extremely resource-use-efficient crop in terms of genetics and physiology, is a very good candidate. So we need to take advantage of this thing. Now, the approach to this, how do we all agree that we need to increase the total output of maize in our country. We need to do so at cost effectiveness in an efficient manner so that the farmers are once again incentivized because they realize higher income. So if that is the mantra or the secret sauce of promoting maize cultivation in India, we should be looking at what exactly are the constraints today that face maize cultivation and address those. I was going through the different topics that you have outlined for the day's discussion, and they are fairly comprehensive, and you are addressing end to end. I'm very happy that the emphasis is on post-production, because that's the biggest weakness in our country. It's also agreed that, yes, productivity is extremely low in India, that while Indian production system competes globally in every segment of the agriculture, it fares very badly when it comes to productivity. Every single crop productivity is extremely low. But then let's not lose heart. It gives us a signal, an opportunity, that India now has got the scope to multiply the production by actually focusing on productivity. And the productivity is the only way forward of enhancing increased production. The reason, of course, is that agriculture, which is dependent on land, the land is itself under stress. Over the last one decade, the area under cultivation has reduced by 0.8 to 1 million hectares. The reason is that there is competition from alternate demands, whether it's urbanization, infrastructure, industry, and it is bound to happen. Well, we are also keen that we need to shift a part of the population engaged in agriculture today to non-agricultural activities. Because today, the 48% which depends on agriculture directly and indirectly, in terms of absolute number, is higher than the population of the United States. And we need to ensure that we find answer to the disguised unemployment and the underemployment that characterizes Indian agriculture. This is the only way that we can actually transform the human resource productivity, make it much more productive in terms of contribution as well as income generation and therefore the welfare. Now, maize, therefore, which is a good candidate as a human consuming commodity, as a feed and fodder, and also as an industrial raw produce, we need to now look at how do we now, the broad three categories of field corn, and the second one, the specialized corn, whether it is the baby corn and the sweet corn, how do we now specialize into cluster-based production of these three different segments? Within the field corn, once again, we have the normal, the common maize, then we got the quality protein maize, we got the oil-containing maize, and then we also the waxy maize. So there are different categories. So we now need to categorize based on the agroclimatic zones and based on the resource endowments as to what category of this particular corn we should be focusing on. The reason being that this production has to be linked up to the post-production, right from the farm harvest to the storage, to the transportation, and other forms of agri-logistics, which alone can actually drive higher productivity. Now, the productivity, of course, is a function of the genetics, is a function of the resources that we provide. Now, unfortunately, in India, as far as genetic potential is concerned, we have not been able to exploit it to the extent it can. Only 30% of the total maize area in the country is under the single hybrid cross. Now, the single hybrid crosses are very important. It's not that that is ultimate. We have to go to double hybrid crosses. We need to go to three-way crosses. I am sure that researchers who are going to sit here, will be here today, will discuss how do we increase the area under SHC, double hybrids, as well as three-way crosses. Luckily, Bihar and Tamil Nadu are the two states which have shown that it is possible. Over the last 10 years, these are the two states where 100% of their cultivated area under maize has come under single cross hybrids. Now, over the last 10 years, since 2006-07, if you see, while maize has grown well, there are four states, three southern states, Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, and Karnataka, and one state in North India, Bihar, have shown that the gross income from maize cultivation per hectare can be substantively increased. These are the only four states in the country which earn more than 40,000 rupees per hectare. Andhra and Tamil Nadu are much better with more than 60,000 rupees per hectare. Now, other states like Madhya Pradesh, Gujarat, Rajasthan, which also have actually done better than these states in terms of ratio of change in their gross income, but still at such a low level that their income from maize is around 25 to 27,000. So that means far below Andhra Pradesh and Karnataka, Tamil Nadu. Now these states, the Western India, on the central plain of India, starting from Madhya Pradesh, Gujarat, Rajasthan, Maharashtra, these are the states which actually have a greater potential now to catch up with states like Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu and Karnataka and Bihar, and then show that yes, India's total production can actually grow up from 27 million tons, which is a peanut compared to what's happening in Brazil and US and China. We just heard from Kurt that they're growing how many for million tons, how many, 270 million tons, I guess I heard. 370 million tons. Now 27 million tons is a drop in the ocean of 370 million tons. So we are just nowhere. And that increase can come only from genetic potential. Now, if our average yield is 2.7 tons today per hectare, whereas the average in China is 6.1, in Brazil is 5.5, and US has gone to 10.2, even if we can actually increase to around 4 tons, which is possible over the next 5 years, our production would have substantively increased. Now, apart from utilizing the genetic potential that is possible, we should be, of course, looking at better agronomic practices. Across the crops in India, what we really see is that what we achieve on the research field, what we achieve under the frontline demonstrations situation, and what we achieve on the farmer's field, there is a catastrophic decline from one stage to another. Between the research claim and ultimately what happens to the farmer's claim, there is a difference of more than 60 to 70%. Why is this leakage happening? That means we have not been able to transfer the right technology, right agronomic practices to the farmers. Therefore, here, apart from the schemes and missions and programs that we have, What's really important is how do we transfer technology through a robust extension machinery. The extension in country has got weak over the last 10 years. You see, not only that manpower-based extension has got weak, we have not been able to replace it suitably by new ICT platforms. The way forward is both ICT platform and manpower-based extension have to be optimally combined to transfer this technology and improve the agronomic practices. So if we can actually combine the genetic potential and the extension to promote agronomic practices, we would be able to achieve 45 million tons that we actually are aiming by 2022. Our initial aim was to achieve 45 million tons by 2030, but 2030 has now been advanced to 2022. The reason is that under the SDG, the country as a signatory is committed to increasing the productivity by 2 times by 2030, incomes from farm by 2 times by 2030. But Honorable Prime Minister has advanced that date that we must double the farmer's income by 2022. So therefore, in every crop segment, all the targets that we had by 2030 have to be now brought down to 2022. So therefore, 45 million tons, which was the target for 2030, has to be brought down and achieved within 2022. And that is possible only account of this. But then let me now give you an optimal picture. That Indian agriculture policy system has undergone a cataclysmic change. And today you have all facilitations. Now maize or any other agriculture commodity, including animal husbandry, requires a post-production facilitation. We have now built that kind of legal framework. Of course, we need to again convince the state governments to adopt that. As you know, we have a new marketing act called the Agriculture Produce and Livestock Marketing Act. And the second important act which will hit the newspapers and the public domain over the next 1 week is the Contract Farming Act. And the new Contract Farming Act that we're already at the final stage will be soon shared with the state governments. So these two, the new marketing act and the Contract Farming Act, are appropriate adjuncts to actually promote a market-oriented production system. And let me also emphasize that when you talk of a Contract Farming Act, we are talking about not just farming practice per se, but also looking at it as a contract for services. Because you may like to simply enter into contact with farmers for certain services. It could be production-oriented services, it could be marketing-oriented services. So the new Contract Farming Act is truly going to be a Contract Farming and Service Act. Okay, so that's going to be a new shift in the thought process of actually bringing about a change. And the third, which is very important, which should be of great interest to you, is that government is now looking at a new market architecture. All along, for the last 60 years, ever since we introduced the APMC Act in this country, the whole focus and mindset has been closed around APMCs. APMCs are principally the primary agriculture wholesale markets, and they are public sector markets. But India, considering that we have 85% of small and marginal farmers, required a foundation below these wholesale markets. How many farmers in this country were able to or are capable even today of accessing the wholesale markets? So therefore, the new market architecture, as notified and announced in the Union Budget, is looking at a foundation of retail markets as assembly points, and second, a reformed wholesale market under the APLM Act, so that we have both private sector and public sector markets competing with each other on a level playing field. And the third one is to actually evacuate the surplus production out of the country through a strong facilitative export market. Unless we have these three rungs of the market architecture, the retail agriculture market, which will serve as assembly points, the wholesale markets, which will be able to discover prices in a competitive manner by competing with one another, and thirdly, evacuating through a facilitative export market, will not be able to actually find a remunerative prices. We should not get stuck with MSP. Please remember, because you're all educated, interested parties about agriculture and the farmer, I would like to share with you, you must spread this idea. MSP is the last resort. It is a social safety net that farmers have to be offered a chance to discover prices which are remunerative. And a remunerative price is not MSP. A remunerative price is always what is more than MSP. So only a competitive, transparent, and a perfect agriculture market, at least near perfect agriculture market, can discover prices which are remunerative. And only when, because agriculture market can never be perfect globally, so therefore we need to fall back upon the MSP as a social safety net. So we must all take care to create a competitive market, and that's what government is trying to do. So I would end up by saying this, that yes, maize is an extremely good candidate, but then once the last part that we should be all focusing is industry. Now, agriculture, which is the primary economic activity, okay, of the entire, of the total economy, has actually two segments, and we need to appreciate that. Agriculture is a primary production system, and also agriculture can be a secondary agriculture. That means within the primary sector, within the primary characteristic of agriculture, the production system, which is primary agriculture, also has a secondary agriculture. We need to promote secondary agriculture. It is secondary agriculture which actually generate more employment, more income. And it is the one which is capable of actually utilizing the slack period. Like say, farmers have employment not more than 180 days in a year. Their lands remain fallow. Human resource and land, these are the only two assets that the farmer has got in surplus. If we can stitch these two together into a secondary agriculture, then we'll be able to create additional job opportunities, additional income, make it actually incentivized for the farmer to take up. So we must utilize the secondary agriculture and promote industries based on maize. Thank you.